Thank you. Good afternoon and welcome everyone. My name is Maya Dilapko. I am the Human Resources and Administration Manager for TrueLogic Online Solutions. So we start. Can you have everybody inside? Okay, so according to Mark Twain, experience is an author's most valuable asset, and I quote, "It's the thing that puts the muscle, breath, and warm blood into the book." As professional and aspiring writers, we often draw on experiences at work as inspiration. Job experience could inform good prose, but here at TrueLogic Online Solutions and at our content department, good writing translates to a good day at work. In our constant pursuit for greatness, we would like to introduce to you our brainchild, the Free Writing Workshops Manila, brought to you by TrueLogic Online Solutions. It's a small series of talks with great local and international writers, which we are hoping will help our young writers of the digital age exercise their craft and learn better the ropes of creative writing. So in each workshop, we will hear about the current trends in writing and about the speaker's works and philosophies. Each workshop will also include varied types of writing exercises, sharing of each participant's work, and afterwards, an open forum. Most importantly, each workshop is going to be very casual, so please find your comfortable place and position. Not lying down. Bring out your pens, phones, tablets, but on silent mode, please. Whatever it is your great minds these days use. So, this is the first of the series of workshops, and we are more than proud to say our first guest speaker is Tim Tomlinson, who will be setting the bar high for whoever will follow. So Tim Tomlinson is a co-founder of New York Writers Workshop and co-author of its popular text, The Portable MFA in Creative Writing. His full-length collection of poems, Requiem for the Tree-Fort I Set on Fire, published by Winter Goose Publishing, is due in fall 2016. Yolanda, an oral history in verse, published by Finishing Line Press, appears this month. He has conducted writing workshops in many places throughout the world, including Australia, China, the Philippines, Singapore, and Thailand. Currently, he resides with his wife, the brilliant Filipino poet, cook, and television remote control monopolizer. I don't know if she'll agree to that. But may I add, pretty and smart. It runs in the family. Dino Rodriguez Tomlinson. They both reside in Brooklyn, New York. Please welcome the avid scuba driver, the yoga instructor, the master teacher of writing with the New York University's Global Liberal Studies, and today's guest speaker, Tim Tomlinson.
Thank you very much for coming, Maya. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. I have such a hard time saying global liberal studies. I always have to come to a full stop at the end of global, but you just made it flow. We need you in New York. I'm happy to be here, and I wanted to tell you a little bit about what I do, what New York Writers Workshop does, what me, my wife and I have been doing over the last maybe 8 to 10 weeks here in the region. And then I'll talk a little bit about some current trends as I see them in writing fiction and nonfiction. And eventually we'll move into an exercise where I'm going to ask everybody here to do a little bit of writing based upon a model that will be very clear, but hopefully stimulating. I think what I'm going to ask you to do is something that in the past everybody's been able to do without much of a problem. And then if we have some time, I'd like to hear a few of your exercise responses, talk about what's going on in your responses, and then take some Q&A. This is interesting to see everybody on beanbags or things like that. It's informal, so if at any point you have a question or you want to make an observation, please interrupt me. We can have a discussion or a conversation more than just me lecturing out this way. I'm much more comfortable with the model that we advocate in New York, which is to have a conversation with classes rather than a full-out lecture. But I can do whatever is necessary. As Maya mentioned, must record this for posterity and Facebook.
Commercial break.
Well, as Maya mentioned, I'm a co-founder of New York Writers Workshop, and this should be going there, but it's not. Where do I point this? Where's Dino? It'll work, no? Maybe just do it on this. That's easier. Okay. So I'm a co-founder of New York Writers Workshop. I'm actually the president of New York Writers Workshop and have been ever since its inception, since I'm the only one of us. The remote control isn't working so well. I'm the only one who knew in advance that I should read Robert's Rules of Order in order to direct meetings. Nobody else cared that much, so I wound up being elected president, and they won't let me quit. I'm president for life, so it seems. That has its perks. I get to travel around, and it's a good calling card. New York Writers Workshop is a collective of writers and teachers who live in the New York area primarily, and we do all sorts of workshops in just about any kind of writing you can think of. Maybe the only one we have not done is cookbooks. But we have one of our authors whose classes always fill has just published a very successful cookbook. And we expect one from Dito sometime soon. I teach workshops in poetry and in fiction, sometimes creative nonfiction or memoir. I mentioned that I have a couple of books coming out, one very soon. It should have been out before we came here, the one called Yolanda, and another one due out next fall. But I also write fiction. I write short stories. I'm working on a novel of linked short stories. And I mentioned these things, and I'll come back to some of the work that I do and have done, just as an indication of things one might do in order to juice up the creativity, play with the imagination, see what's allowed, see what you can get away with. That's the wrong way. Okay. And this is our book. Maybe 3 or 4 years into the existence of New York Writers Workshop, we were asked to put together a craft book. The Portable MFA in Creative Writing covers 5 major aspects that often get taught in MFA programs. 2 types of nonfiction, memoir, personal essay, and magazine writing, poetry, dramatic writing, and I wrote the section on fiction, and I wrote the introduction. I don't ordinarily include the fact that I have an MFA. I attended Columbia University School of the Arts for my MFA. I often don't mention it because, and this, I'm reminded of this hearing your introduction, right? The idea of Mark Twain, that experience is the muscle of the imagination, or something like this?
It's the thing that puts the muscle, breath, and warm blood into the book.
Okay. I think all of those things were sucked out of us at the MFA program. I did very well in the program. My work was generally respected, if not admired. So I didn't leave there feeling as if I had been eviscerated or hurt, but I didn't feel as if I learned anything either. What the Portable MFA purports to do is save you maybe $49,984, since it's only $16. That's in the old days when the MFA only cost $50,000. These days, I think the average cost is $50,000 per year, so you're talking about $100,000. This is only $16,000. But I mention this too because in the MFA program, in the introduction, I attempted to be descriptive. I wanted to communicate my experience of the MFA program. So it's not a blanket description of every MFA program or MFA programs in general, but you might extrapolate from my experience. And it turned out that what I described in the introduction represented the experience of many, many people who went through my program at Columbia and many of the other really well-known, very prestigious MFA programs. You may be familiar with the name the Iowa Writing Program, right? And if you're a fan of girls, you may have seen Lena Dunham go down to Iowa and go through that program. We get a lot of Iowa students at New York Writers Workshop, and we call all the people who come in with MFAs recovering MFAs. They don't really know how to continue writing. They seem to have been derailed by the experience, and we try to reorient them through craft, primarily. When we put together the book, I put together a team of our New York Writers Workshop instructors, and we had one poet in particular who I wanted to write the section on poetry. But when she read my introduction, she said, I can't be a part of this book, because it was too harsh, she thought. She said, this will never get me a job. This will prevent any of us getting jobs. So we got another poet to do it. And I mentioned this because a couple of weeks ago, we started our most recent visit to the Philippines at UP. There was a conference of the Asia Pacific Writers and Translators at UP. It was at UP for 2 days, and then we moved over to UST and LaSalle. Yeah, we covered all the bases. Everything but Ateneo. Sorry. At the conference was the director of the creative writing program from the University of Iceland, of all places. And he noticed, I had sat in on a workshop with him, and he saw the name New York Writers Workshop, and then he was looking at my wife's name tag. Said Deal Tomlinson, and he said to her, you know, Tomlinson, that sounds familiar. And she said, well, my husband is with New York Writers Workshop. And he said, oh, and that sounds familiar. Is there a book affiliated with New York Writers Workshop? And Deal said, yeah, the Portable MFA in Creative Writing. And he said, I use that book. And then Deal called me over. And the way he uses the book primarily is he takes the introduction. I hope he buys copies, but I think he Xeroxes copies. And he distributes the introduction to the faculty. And before they begin each semester, they go over the introduction as a means to prevent some of the things that occur that are negatives in MFA programs from happening in the University of Iceland. And I was so gratified to hear that because, you know, every now and then I look at reviews on Amazon or I hear something from other people on blogs that the introduction is so harsh and so bitter. It's actually a tool now to prevent some of the negatives from occurring. So if you ever pick this book up or if you look at the introduction, I hope you recall that and just think about how certain negatives come up a whole bunch and they're really destructive. You know, the Hippocratic Oath, right? At least do no harm. And the MFA program should at least be that, but it often does harm. I saw so many casualties coming out of the Columbia program, and we still deal with that. Anyway, that's how we began. When we came over here, we started at UP at the Asia Pacific Writers and Translators. And then we went down to the Ubud Writers and Readers Festival, where I launched this book. Yolanda and Oral History First. So I launched the book without the book. It was supposed to come out 3 days before we came east, and it got delayed. And we were hoping that it's out by the time we get back to New York at the end of this week. It's at the printer, and we have a reading and a presentation on Saturday, December 12th, back in New York. We may be defaulting to images. Yolanda and Oral History in Verse is one of the things that the strategy of this book is available to anyone for creative writing. It's kind of nonfiction poetry. What we did, just to backtrack a bit, in July of 2013, Dietl and I traveled to Techlovon and we did workshops at the university over 3 days. They were like three times the population of this room. It was a huge auditorium. And the workshop was very successful. And we just loved the people. It was one of the warmest receptions we've ever had. We spent time at the near the university in the university housing. And then, of course, 3 months later, we heard that the typhoon came and wiped out so much of the city. And we wanted to do something that would help or commemorate or something. And we wound up coming up with this project where we went back to Techlovon, all around Leyte, into Samar, and we interviewed people who had survived Yolanda. We taped their discussions of what they experienced, and then we transcribed the tapes, which is very painstaking. If you're ever going to do any work like this, I would recommend limiting your interviews to maybe 15 minutes max, because even that will keep you very busy. Some of the interviews we had went on for an hour plus, so transcribing what everyone said was meticulous and really time-consuming. That said, very often the best part of the interview showed up maybe 55 minutes in, so in a certain way it was a good thing to allow for a long discussion. Once we gathered all the material, I began going through the transcripts and breaking the statements that we received into poems. I tried to do a number of different forms in the poems, but the condition I put on myself was that I would not use any of my own words. So Yolanda is composed solely on the words of those who survived the typhoon. And I tried to capture the sound of the speakers as much as possible. To a certain extent, I think I succeeded. Some of the transcripts obviously were translated from Morai or from Cebuano, and that presented certain interesting challenges. Anyway, this is what we started with. We came over here down in Ubi, then to Ubud, and then we did a little bit more of a regional traipse. In Ubud was our friend Eliza Vitri Handayani. We met her earlier at the Ubi conference. Before we got down to Ubud, there was some controversy. I wonder if you guys heard about this. There were a number of panels, a film, and a couple of readings scheduled, each of which was going to, at least in part, reference the massacre in 1965 of a whole bunch of communist insurrectionists. Maybe 3 or 4 days before the festival launched, the Indonesian government decided that this was not a good thing to have at the festival. So they put a lid on it. And the film was canceled, then the panels were canceled, then the readings were canceled, and Eliza was going to read from her new novel called From Now On, Everything Will Be Different, and they shut that down. Even though, if I understand this correctly, she doesn't even mention the massacre in 1965, but there was a reference to something that happened in the 80s, and they thought it was too controversial. So they shut down her book as well, very sadly. This is her kind of passive protest. This t-shirt is a page of the book, and the image here is the book cover. So every day at the festival, she came with a new t-shirt with a page from the book. We read 3 pages of the book because she had it on her chest. And this was her kind of passive protest. It got a lot of coverage in the press, but the festival compromised rather than get shut down entirely. So this is one of the interesting things that we encountered in our tour of the region. We came back here for Promotex Rebooted, and I mentioned this because the whole Promotex experience is a way to think about the hybrids that are available to the writer today. So Promotex Rebooted over at CCB is a gathering of paintings, sculptures, installations, photographs, mixed with text. What we did is we hung some pictures that I've taken underwater in various locations in the Philippines, and then some photographs from our interviews in Tacloban. A couple of those are Deedle's photographs. And we connected those to text. So, for the images from scuba diving, I drew from poems I've written about scuba diving. Are there any divers here? Anybody dive? Nobody dives? Snorkel, that's not. you're living in one of the great dive areas of the world. Diving is such an extraordinary, otherworldly experience. If you need stimulation of your imagination, one of the best things you can do is put yourself into a new zone. And going underwater into somebody else's zone can do that for you. It's also a great way just to have silence. I used to have a girlfriend who drove me crazy, and she said, way before I met Deedle. The two things I loved doing were scuba diving and the opera. And she said that I liked those two things the most because she couldn't talk to me. Anyway, the scuba diving does wonderful things. It loosens the imagination and gives you a sense of how minuscule we really are in the big scheme of things. So this is just another thing where you can bring together or collide two very different impulses and create a new thing. I highly recommend the CCP show from the text because there's a lot of really wild stuff. I would say that what we did might be the most pedestrian in terms of imaginative use of text and image. Some of the visual artists in particular came up with some really fantastic stuff. We continued on down to Dumaguete. Everywhere we went, we encountered text. Sometimes we understood what it meant, and sometimes we thought, I wonder what the hell that is. We thought this might be, you know, for the opening of a bakery. Then we went to Shanghai. That's about it, right? No argument here. But in Shanghai, the visual artists in this this fantastic exhibit, I forget the name of the exhibit, were also really interested in bringing text into image, putting things together, and having a picture plus the text. And often the two were at odds with each other, so a kind of ironic tension would be created. And then this one, we wound up in Chiang Mai, in Thailand. And this is one of my favorites. I think this is maybe profound, or maybe idiotic, I haven't figured it out. If you don't persistent, everything so goods. So when we saw this, you know, we knew we had to have a picture. And then we were trying to figure out, okay, what did this project intend? You know, when I teach workshops, I always tell everyone that my teaching philosophy is really based on Flannery O'Connor's statement about writing fiction and about writing in general. How many of you are familiar with Flannery O'Connor? Okay. So she's best known for short stories. She was from the southern United States, Milledgeville, Georgia. She was a devout Catholic. Kind of a militant Catholic. She died young. She wrote dozens and dozens of short stories. Many of them are world-recognized masterpieces. So everything rises. Everything that rises must converge. That's a Flannery O'Connor story. A good man is hard to find. That might be the most famous one. She said about creative writing that you can do whatever you can get away with. This is very important to remember as any kind of an artist. You can do whatever you can get away with. When you're talking about writing, how do you know whether or not you're getting away with what you attempt? Any ideas? How do you know you're getting away with something on the page? Well, it's really simple. The reader keeps reading. You know, if the reader turns the page and wants to stay with the text, then you're getting away with whatever you're trying. She also said that you'll probably find out you can't get away with very much. So she was an advocate of trying to do whatever you were interested in aesthetically, but she also recognized that the reader has certain expectations and you have to address those. If not, you'll lose the reader. So in reference to this, if you don't persist, well, you know, if you're looking at prose on the page, and you encounter grammatical errors, you might lose the reader. The reader might say, I value my time, and I'm not going to struggle with something that doesn't make any sense. But maybe if you spend a little more time with this, you can imagine that there's some intention that makes it kind of interesting. I haven't figured out exactly what this writer means. It might mean two things. And ambiguity is useful in fiction, maybe not so much in nonfiction. I think it might mean that if you don't strive too hard, good things will come. So that's kind of like the Zen idea that the surest way to hit a target is to aim indirectly. That if you go directly at something, you might miss it completely. But it also might mean that you have to persist or you won't get anything good. I'm not really certain. I think both of those apply, though, to creative writing. You have to keep doing it. You have to be really persistent. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But if you work too hard, you might see it slipping away. You might see the energy of your impulse just dissipating, and you'll wind up with labor instead of inspiration on the page. That's no good either. I'll probably come back to this this slide. So, you know, you're often taught that things have to work in a particular way. And what I'm advocating here is doing whatever you can get away with, trying whatever you want, and seeing if it works. in fiction and poetry. It works if the reader continues with whatever you guys are doing creatively. It works if it gets across. And if somebody's attention wanders for a moment, you've lost. So it's important to, I think, suspend the rigid positions. When you go to creative writing programs, you hear this over and over again. If you're a fan of the interviews of some of the contemporary writers in America, many of them went through MFA programs, and they all kind of come out thinking, I encountered rigid positions. The instructors were all telling me I had to work in a certain way, and that's not the way I work. And many of them stuck to their aesthetic guns and wound up taking literature to a different level. So a good example might be David Foster Wallace. Do we have any David Foster Wallace fans here? He had a miserable experience at the University of Arizona. They were actually going to let him go after the first year. They do an evaluation at the end of two semesters. And they didn't know this, but the work that they hated the most that he was handing into the workshop was already under contract with Little Brown back in New York to be a book. And the book became Girl with Curious Hair. So when that was published, and it did very well and got great reviews, and so many of the young critics were saying, this is taking us in a new direction, they hated him even more. There's nothing they hate more in MFA programs than an early success. But he wound up making it all the way through, and then his life becomes terribly tragic. So I invite you to investigate what happens with David Foster Wallace. He's no longer with us. But his book, Infinite Jest, is one of the milestones of 20th century literature. Are you familiar with it? This is a book where there might be more footnotes than there are in story. It's 1,100 pages. I don't know how many people have actually gotten all the way through or all the way through the footnotes, but it's a remarkable read, and it's he's a challenging but inspiring writer. And a lot of young people like him. I've noticed being over here many, many times that he has a lot of fans in the Philippines because he's breaking rules and doing things in a very different way. This is another example of something that you can do. So the writer Rick Moody, of whom I'm not really a big fan, every now and then attempts something that's different, attempts to bring two different impulses together, marry sources, and come up with something new and fresh. So this is a story called Primary Sources, and it looks more like an annotated bibliography to a research paper than it resembles a short story. How many people are familiar with The New Yorker? Do you read The New Yorker or look at its cartoons? That's about as far as I go. But The New Yorker is probably the most prestigious place in the States to have work published. So the editor of The New Yorker thought he got away with this. This is, you probably can't read it, I apologize for the fuzziness, but these are all book titles, right? Can I read any of these? Well, he lists book titles, he lists authors, and he lists experiences and record albums. And he may also list drugs, because these are the primary sources that make up the research project Rick Moody. It's kind of an autobiography as research paper, as annotated bibliography. And then when you drop down below the line, you see the footnotes for each one of these. And the footnotes really tell the story. Little by little, as you go through 1, 2, 3, 4, you begin to get a sense that it's actually telling the story of his young life all the way up until maybe a little bit postgraduate. So this is kind of an ingenious way to address one's life. It's not, he circumvented the anxiety of writing scintillating sentences, because really all he has here is a list, a bibliography, followed by explanations of each one. You'd be hard-pressed to find a literary style in the footnotes. There is one there, and it may conform to some of Rick Moody's other work. But in general, he's just speaking to the pattern of scholarship, and he's suggesting this is just as valid a way to write a story as anything else. And then, it depends on whether or not you stick with it. And if you do, then you got away with it. Luckily, this story is short enough for just about everybody to reach the end. I don't know if I want to go through a novel like this, but I read research papers. I know how itemizing those are, so the shorter the better. This is my own. You know, I thought after reading the Moody piece, I thought, what if I tried to do my own primary sources, the books that meant a lot to me, or the experiences that meant a lot to me, and what if instead of going for 20 pages, I wrote a sonnet? So this is a sonnet. This is 14 lines. It's not a strict, formal Shakespearean sonnet, right? It doesn't have iambic pentameter. But there is a modest attempt at rhyming, and it conforms to the look of Shakespeare's sonnets. So this was something that I just did as a personal challenge. I thought, well, let me give myself an exercise, see if I can do my books in sonnet form so I don't really detain the reader. And it was published. This was published by a magazine called Word Riot. And that's something else that I think is really important, right? If you're doing something, if you're trying to get away with something, and you don't really know what it is, and you're looking at it, well, a good idea is to send it out. You know, let somebody else tell you what it is. So I sent it out, and a bunch of places sent it back, thanks but no thanks. And one place said, I'll tell you what it is, it's a poem. There it is. So every now and then, I put to myself the exercises or the inspirations that I see from others and try to twerk it a little bit and see what happens. That's something else you can do. You can borrow from whatever you see. You probably know the statement, good poets borrow, great poets steal. I think that was T.S. Eliot who said that, although you hear it attributed to all sorts of people. Here's another poem. This is by Robert Haas. And this is another example, I think, of, you know, trying new things. Actually, this is an old thing, but it seems new because we haven't seen it much until the last maybe 15 years. So Ezra Pound's proposition really begins like an essay, right? Robert Haas is a poet, but he also writes criticism. He also writes cultural criticism and essays. But more and more, and especially coming over here at Ateneo, this is the first time I had this discussion with someone at Ateneo, they were telling me that they're recognizing more and more that the poem is more like an essay than it is like narrative, or that the essay is more like a poem than it is like other narrative. And you can go through contemporary, the racks of contemporary poets and find that this is actually true. People who are doing things that are very different, they're not like the imagist haikus, for instance. They're not simply addressing an image and trying to connect that to a broader understanding of the world. They're actually writing something like essays. And so this one, he's borrowing from Ezra Pound in the beginning, beauty is sexual and sexuality is the fertility of the earth. But then he goes into an event. One night in Bangkok, the poet encounters a young girl who turns out to be a prostitute. And then he thinks about what that means in the broader geopolitical sense. And this is what he comes up with, right? He's tracing the trends in Thailand, the movement of money from the supranational corporations, and how it winds up into this encounter on the night in Bangkok. So it's an essay, it's a lyric poem, it's a hybrid. And again, I mentioned this just to stress how many things you can do, how many things are available to the writer today. There are no more, if there ever were, there are no more rules that you must follow. There's really only your imagination. Give it a shot, send it around, get your friends to take a look at what you're doing, or your clients, and see what comes up. Chances are you'll stumble onto something if you allow yourself to wander around and experiment. If instead you attempt to imitate slavishly everything that's come before, or slavishly imitate what your professors tell you you have to do, then you're probably going to wind up, I don't know, not publishing your work, chances are. I want to talk a little bit about some of the broader tips that I always go over in writing workshops. So one thing that's important is to avoid the sense of the sanctity of the first draft. You probably know this from many of your work, right? Your first inspiration, that's just a way to get going. And some writers will tell you different quantities, but almost everybody agrees that the first 10 minutes, the first hour, the first 10 days, whatever it is, that's all bullshit. And you got to get it out of you before you get to the stuff that really matters. So you do your draft, and then you take a look at what you have and think about what kind of ideas are important to you, important enough to get on the page, and then you start to think about what's the value here. One of our colleagues at New York Writers Workshop always tells the writers that she works with that you have to give yourself the liberty to make a mess on the page. I call that word vomit, working off the Bob Dylan story about how he wrote like a Rolling Stone. Any Bob Dylan fans here? Too young to be a Bob Dylan fan? So Bob Dylan talked about how he did a tour of England in 1965. And by the time he reached the end of the tour, he had decided he was going to quit the music business. He had already taken a contract from a New York City publishing house to write a novel. And that novel was published, and it's execrable. I wouldn't recommend it, except if you can find it as a PDF. It's called Tarantula, and I think even he knew it sunk. He realized that he couldn't write. He was trying to get away with everything, and he didn't know that you can, how does that go? He didn't know that you can't get away with very much. He was trying to get away with telling the story the way stories are told. Didn't work. But on the flight home from London to New York, he was so disgusted and so angry that he took out his notebook, and as he describes it, he vomited on the page for 20 pages. He wrote freehand 20 pages. And when he got back to New York, he was going over what he wrote, and he thought, this looks like it's something that I can use. And out of the 20 pages of word vomit, he came up with the four verses of Like a Rolling Stone. And when he, obviously when he went into the recording studio, he said, this is my new voice, this is the new vein I'm opening up. And then for the next maybe 18 months or 2 years, a lot of what he did sounded like it was coming out of the same muse as Like a Rolling Stone. Nobody wrote better anger songs than Bob Dylan. He's got so many wonderful put-down songs, as well as so many love songs. I'm a big fan, and I'm always anxious whenever I see text that he's written, because I'm afraid to find out if I don't like him. I'm afraid to find out that he's not as great as I think he is. So when his memoir came out called Chronicles, I didn't read it for about a year. I was too afraid to lose my opinion of him. But when I picked it up, it only reinforced the opinion 100-fold. I highly recommend Bob Dylan's Chronicles. It's a wonderful book. It's so plugged into an interesting American idiom. So the language is exciting all the way through. But it's also a book about, if there's any theme that he keeps on coming to, it's here's what happened to me when I couldn't write anymore. And what did I do when I encountered the wall? So each one of the big sections reaches a point where he's just unable to do any more work. And then he figures out another way around it. That's a good point to remember, right? That the process includes the long haul. And the solution you find for one project, one poem, one short story, one book, that might not be the solution for the next one. The writer Richard Ford used to say that, you know, when an architect finishes designing a building, he can do another building. But when a writer starts a new book, it's like they're learning right from the very beginning. It's like you don't know anything. And the project has to inform you what it is. And I think that's what Chronicles is about, how each time out, Dylan was finding that, God, I'm just completely stumped. I feel like an amateur. And then he found a way around, usually through inspiration, through some kind of eureka moment. So the 17th line, I always tell the story in my workshops. The poet Robert Lowell, who was teaching at Harvard when this story supposedly took place, was working with a group of students who were writing advanced poems. And on the day that this occurred, a woman had submitted a 17-line poem. So everybody in the workshop talked about the poem, and then Robert Lowell jumped in, which is kind of the Iowa model. The professor withholds any kind of comment until everybody else talks. And then Robert Lowell began by saying, this is a fantastic poem. This work is great. Get rid of the first 16 lines, your poem starts here. So what he was saying is that everything that you do on the page is important. Everything that you do for your work is important. Some of it might get crumpled up and thrown away, but you cannot get to line 17 if you don't do the first 16. So when you're thinking about how hard it is to do whatever the imaginative work is that you're doing, you want to remember to respect your process and be very forgiving of early drafts, of early efforts. They don't represent the totality of your ability, they're only the start. This is one of the reasons why I had such, and continue to have such, a conflicted opinion about the MFA programs. Because if they do anything that I think is the big mistake, is that they treat everything that comes into the programs as if they are the final best product of the writer, and then of course that they represent the writer as well. I like to turn that upside down, the other way around, and that the piece is a piece in process. You know the expression, fail once, fail again, fail better, that all writing is just a failure, and all you could hope to do if you're a writer is fail a little bit better the next time. So it's very important to remember the process, not the product, not to get too hung up on the excellence of the product. Just remember how you get to the place you're going. These two are pretty simple, right? If it bores you, it's going to bore the reader. If it excites you, it'll probably excite the reader. And I want to give you a couple of examples of things that I've looked at recently that, to a certain extent, illustrate this. So a friend had asked me to take a look at an essay that she was writing to apply to a master's program. I think the university has several locations, one in Australia, a couple in Europe. And the program that she's applying to has something to do with management and organization. I'm not 100% certain what it is, because most of my impressions were based upon the essay. So this is her first draft. Project management has always been something that I've been interested in, even before I heard the term or knew what it meant. I suppose I've always thought. So already I'm starting to get bored. I'm starting to lose my attention. It seems like it's generic prose, nothing concrete, nothing significant. And then we get to paragraph two. One of my memorable accomplishments during grade school was completing the yearbook. And I just thought, is there anything more boring than the yearbook? what admissions officer would be interested in this application? So the writing is slack. And the focus is abysmal. There's just nothing happening in this piece of any interest for me. But this is the first draft, right? So this is an attempt at getting to material that's worth cultivating. Now, a bit further down in the essay, the writer gets to something that I think would be really interesting for an administrator to consider. And that is after earthquakes or after other natural disasters that seem to occur on a regular basis here in the Philippines. She goes into remote villages and she brings with her teams various instruments of power and electricity to those who have lost their homes, lost their any kind of power. So I think this essay is a good example of, you know, the difference between the generic writer who's not really plugged into or accustomed to cultivating the imagination and the writer. Because the writer would begin with the earthquake. And if you think about the hybrids that are available to you, right, with these days we have the term creative nonfiction, CNF, which kind of embraces anything that brings together both fact and imagination, or fact and the tools of fiction. So this essay desperately needs the tools of fiction. And is that my phone? I was just about to shout at someone. I thought that was my phone. Who's calling me over here? If this began with, do you want to take a look at it? Okay, oh, this is a good opportunity for me to drink water.
Okay.
And so far, nobody has stopped me, nobody has wanted to ask a question. Everything is clear to you, or we're okay?
Yeah.
We're good.
Yeah, so I think the creative writer would begin with the earthquake, create a scene, like the fiction writer, right? So that means you have the liberty to get a little bit lyrical, maybe not necessarily to change the facts, but to imagine them for the reader in a way that's compelling. And I think if the admissions people saw an essay about a young woman who's going off into disaster areas and risking at least her comfort for the benefit of others, and if she put that together in a compelling way, in a way that made the experience vivid for the reader, then she'd have a leg up. And you know, once you have the reader's attention, you can get away with a lot, right? But if you stumble in the beginning, it's almost impossible to get their attention. That's the way I am as a reader. If I'm not pulled in immediately, I'm just looking for the excuse to put the book down. And that's the experience of editors as well, right? I edit the fiction section of a literary webzine called Ducks. And I know from my own experience and from the experience of many editors that you really only have a couple of lines, maybe a couple of pages if you're lucky. And if it's not happening in that very short space of time, well, you go to something that will turn you on immediately because there's thousands and thousands of them. It's not as if there's too few manuscripts coming in. There's always way too many, and so the job of the editor becomes, how do I say no as quickly as possible so I can get to lunch on time? This, I think the reader would make a very quick decision on this essay. You can't find it? Isn't it? Don't worry about it. Okay, so I'll show you another example of something I looked at recently. Now, this was given to me by a woman who is a published writer, and she has a collection of short stories, and she was applying for a job at a prestigious East Coast university. They're hiring people to teach fiction to graduate students, to the MFA classes. So this was her statement of teaching philosophy. And just in terms of, you know, the economy of the line, I see that I could cut maybe 30% of the language of the paragraph and have it much tighter. So if you say on the page, I'd like to talk for a moment about, well, why don't you just start talking? How about the writing workshop? And then she's doing these parentheticals, as I think many would not. The writing workshop is give me a verb, do the detail, give the detail the verb, activate the language, make it vivid. Now again, this is a first draft, so it might be unfair to pick it apart, but it actually turned out, you know, much to my chagrin, to be the draft she sent in. Because by the time I got my comments to her, she said past deadline, and she her son had been sick. So she couldn't take a look at any revisions, so she just hoped, okay, this will get through. Now, it's not bad, but it's not good. And when you have hundreds of applications to go through, you need to have that experience right away of something really grabbing you. Now, further down in this essay, maybe by the end of the second page, this writer described an experience she'd had actually at Columbia University in the School of the Arts, in that MFA program. She was in a workshop, this is maybe like 12, 15 years earlier, in a workshop, and she's Chinese-American. She's from Hong Kong, and she was writing a story called The Handover. So she was trying to use a character in Hong Kong, an old man who was thinking through all the issues pertaining to the handover of Hong Kong in, I think it was 1999, is that correct? Okay. Okay. So I'm just like the guy that she complains about in her anecdote. So she read her story, or handed in her story to the workshop, and the instructor was white, male, American. And the instructor said, the story has no historical context. And she said, well, for whom? And he said, well, I don't understand any of this history. And she said, but maybe a billion people do. And he said, if you want to risk losing the reader as you're losing me, keep it the way you have it. Otherwise, tailor your story for the American audience, because we don't understand this. Now that to me is an interesting experience, right? Where the white male instructor, the white male American, assumes that his perspective is the perspective that must be targeted. And if you miss that target, you miss publication, or you miss the point that you're trying to do right from the beginning, which is to communicate a story. And my recommendation to her was put that up front. Often when you do something, and because she wrote it like a scene, there was back and forth, and she got a little bit hilariously sassy, and you know, she stuck to her guns, and the story was published. If you reprioritize and begin with the scene and work with the tools of fiction or narrative nonfiction, then you'll have the reader right away. And this is something that's so important, I think, to the audience that she was writing to. She's writing to writers slash academics in a prestigious East Coast university. That means that they're hyper alert to all the issues pertaining to subject, position, theory and fiction, death of the author, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I think she missed the boat by starting with this, but she wound up with her line 17 buried in the midst of the text on page 2. I'll be very interested to see what happens with this application. But this this brings up something that's important, I think, certainly for the world of MFAs and the world of imaginative work in universities. I don't know, are you guys fans of Juno Diaz?
Yes.
The Dominican-born, New Jersey-based, maybe not New York-based writer. But he might be up in Boston these days. Juno Diaz has won every major prize that writers can win. He's probably under 45. He went through an MFA program from one at Cornell. And now he writes very critically of MFA programs because he says that in his own experience, you know, he was the only person of color in his workshop maybe 25 years ago, and that the perspective was almost exclusively, if not exclusively, white, and white American, and mostly white American male. So he said everybody who didn't conform to that was already alienated, and that lasted for 2 years. And that's the experience he had that he thinks is representative of the MFA scene over in the States in general. I don't know if it's like that so much these days. But he cited Toni Morrison, the great Nobel Prize winner novelist. He cited Toni Morrison as a great example of inspiration to him because early on in her career, people were telling her, you're missing the target, you know, white American women aren't interested in this, or they don't understand this. And Toni Morrison said, I'm not writing to white American women, I'm writing to black women. That's my audience. So I admire her position, I admire her stance, I admire her spirit. I don't know if I admire the work. You know, I go through Toni Morrison books, I've read a bunch of them, and they don't electrify me. So I always feel bad about not loving her the way I love her, but I don't love the books, and I want to love the books the way I love her. But I say that because it's important to remember that we're not here to be polite. We're here to tell stories, and you can risk doing something or saying something that's unpopular, that's the way to get your truth across. Because one final remark before we do an exercise. The writer Susan Sontag said that great writers have four qualities. The four qualities are the obsessive, the fool, the stylist, and the critic. The obsessive is constantly doing the work, constantly returning to the things that get the work going. So let's say you had an abysmal childhood, you keep going back to the childhood and writing about it over and over and over again. The fool is crazy enough to put it out there and think anybody's interested in it. So the fool is okay with risking great public humiliation because the fool can't stop him or herself from putting the work out there. The stylist is concerned with the quality of the prose or the quality of whatever the writing is. Is it lyrical enough, poetic enough? Is it sharp enough? And then the critic is always saying, it's not good enough. This isn't smart enough. You can't do that. And she made the observation that a good writer can have the first two qualities. You have to have the obsessive and you have to have the fool. And the fool is kind of, you know, the person who will do the work on it. You know, just get it out there and see what happens. And the obsessive meaning that you have to do with that sign said a while ago, if you don't persist in, good things won't come. You have to, so that might be the obsessive. You have to have those two qualities. You can get away with not being the critic and not being the stylist, although the great writers have all four. So if you're interested only in telling stories that communicate, then they don't have to be of the highest caliber prose. The critic is at war with the fool, right? The critic is always telling the fool, no, you can't do that. And that's the thing I think that we all have to defeat the most. Because if you're interested at all in expressing yourself eloquently, you're probably conversant with so much other work that expresses itself really well. And you always think mine isn't doing that. And that's why I recommend sending work out and getting feedback. Even if the feedback is thanks but no thanks. It's just a way to bounce your work off people in the business who do offer an opinion, even if it's just a rejection. So I wanted to preface and exercise with all of this discussion. Do you guys have anything you want to ask me or point out before we do a little bit of work together?
What
is an example of a fool? Well, I think by Susan Sontag's definition, anybody who's getting potentially shameful material out there might qualify as a fool. I don't know if anything's shameful anymore. I don't know what the scene is here, but in the States, the confessional impulse has become comic, tragic. But I'll tell you one example that comes to mind immediately. This is a very controversial memoir that came out sometime in the 90s by a writer named Catherine Harrison. Catherine Harrison already had several novels published. She was well on her way to have a big literary career. And then she published a book called, and she was married to an editor of Harper's Magazine, and she had a couple of children. So in her mid-30s or late-30s, however, she decided that she had to publish a memoir that concerned something. The memoir was called The Kiss, and the story was about an extended affair that Catherine Harrison, the author, had with her own father. So is that a fool? A lot of people said, how can you do that? Your children are going to school right down the street, and everybody's going to know. What are you doing to them? So that was one major criticism of her choice. And it really significantly altered her career. She became much less of a public figure after that, and I think it was because the response was so visceral and generally negative. So a lot of people reviewed the book without having read the book, and the attack was outrageous. I have not read the book, but I had the same kind of feeling, like, oh my God, I'll admit a lot, but I don't know if I'm going to talk about things I've done with my parents. Did you have a question?
No, who has a question? Me? I think David Sedaris is a good example. He makes fun of his family. Who's familiar with David? Like, me talk pretty one day, it talks about his sputtering and his gay relationship with a physician. It's like autobiography, and he doesn't really care what people will say after reading his book, and it's really great. You guys should read it.
That's right, and David Sedaris has a major career, right? He's widely read, widely loved. That's another important thing to think about. You know, when you're addressing your news, when you're trying to get your work out there, if you're the fool and you put it on the page or on the video or whatever it is, take a risk, generally what you find is you're not unique, right? That your experience touches so many hundreds or thousands of people who have similar experiences. I don't think Catherine Harrison had that many people who said, wow, that's just like my own experience. And that might be one of the reasons why the book encountered such flack. I was never a fan of Catherine Harrison, so I can't really comment on the quality of her prose, at least as I see it. But I understand that she's a gifted writer with a very lyrical style, so I imagine The Kiss is using the tools of her toolkit in a similar way to the fiction. The fiction often, according to what I've read, the fiction often kind of circled around this central theme. So she's the fool, and I think also the obsessive. She kept coming back to this thing, and finally she just thought, you know what? I have to take the window dressing off this and put it out there as a memoir. I have to do nonfiction. I just started a memoir a little while ago, and it really had a very interesting effect. You know, to step away from the artifice and to just put things out there, it's a certain amount of exposure that I wasn't really considering. And that can be liberating, but it can also be, we'll see. I don't think Dita will let me embarrass myself too much. Anyone else? Okay, so it's probably better to do an exercise, do some writing, and then talk about what comes up. So can we distribute that? So before we get into this, everybody should have paper, pen, and or iPad, or whatever you should write on, available. So this exercise is an attempt at creating a childhood map. What I'm asking you to think about is where you grew up, your first recollection of an address, we'll use this model by Van Morrison, the Irish rock and roll folk rock singer. He always calls himself Rhythm and Blues. But Van Morrison was a successful, I guess, second string rock and roll star by 1965 or 1966, right? He had a rock group in Ireland called Them, and they had two major league hits. And on the basis of the hits, he moved to the U.S., which he thought would be more conducive and more remunerative to his career. To a certain extent, it was. He lived in the U.S. for maybe another 6 or 7 years, produced a number of enduring albums. You may know the album Moon Dance or Astral Weeks. Both these records are considered among the greatest records ever made. So he did some very significant work in the U.S. But maybe after 5 or 6 years, he started to feel very disconnected from who he was. He wasn't quite certain why that was, but his eventual decision, maybe by the mid-70s, was to move back to Ireland and to remain where he has for the rest of his life, somewhere in the U.K. And he's always touring, maybe 100 days out of the year, but he's remained in the U.K. and mostly in and around Belfast, where he grew up, Northern Ireland. And he started to write a lot about his childhood. So he has these, do you know the Beatles songs, Penny Lane and Strawberry Fields? These are childhood songs. He wanted to do the same thing. He wanted to evoke an experience of his own childhood. And this one is really spoken word. On Hindford Street is really just Van Morrison speaking against a backdrop of a kind of, almost like a church organ. It almost feels like you're going into a service, and someone is playing a kind of gospel organ. There are a couple of other instruments that come in very atmospherically, but for the most part, it's just a wash of mellow organ and Van Morrison reciting these words. So he grew up on Hindford Street, and I'll just read through the poem, and then I'll ask you guys to do something very similar to what he's done here. Take me back. Take me way, way, way back on Hindford Street, where you could feel the silence at 11:30 on long summer nights. As the wireless played Radio Luxembourg and voices whispered across Beachy River in the quietness as we sank into restless slumber in the silence and carried on dreaming in God. And walks up Cherry Valley from North Road Bridge railway line on sunny summer afternoons, picking apples from the side of the tracks that spilled over from the gardens of the houses on Cypress Avenue, watching the moth catcher working the floodlights in the evenings, and meeting down by the pylons, playing around Mrs. Kelly's lamp, going out to Hollywood on the bus and walking from the end of the line to the seaside, stopping at Fusco's for ice cream in the days before rock and roll. Hindford Street, a bed of parade, Orange Field, St. Donard's Church, Sunday six bells, and in between the silence there was conversation and laughter and music and singing and shivers up the back of the neck, and tuning into Luxembourg late at night and jazz and blues records during the day, also Debussy on the third program, early mornings when contemplation was best. Going up the Castlereagh Hills and the creaky glens in summer and coming back to Hindford Street, feeling wondrous and lit up inside with a sense of everlasting life. And reading Mr. Jelly Roll and Big Bill Broomsey and Really the Bums, Really the Blues and by Mez Mesro and Dharma Bums by Jack Kerouac over and over again. And voices echoing late at night over Beachy River. And it's always being now. It's always being now. It's always now. Can you feel the silence on Hindford Street, where you could feel the silence at 11:30 on long summer nights as the wireless played Radio Luxembourg and voices whispered across Beachy River, and in the quietness we sank into restless slumber in silence and carried on dreaming in God. So this is a childhood map. This is Van Morrison attempting to recreate the street that he grew up on. You can Google Hindford Street and find where he lived. You'll see that it's really just a row of council houses, very tightly packed, very urban, and that all the places he mentions are generally very close within the sphere of a few blocks, although he does venture out into other locations. But not far. Everything's pretty much in walking distance, except I think Orange Fields. So what I'd like you guys to try to do is something similar, right? To imagine the first address that you really think of as home, and think about what constitutes your experience at that address. So he begins with this command, take me back, take me way, way back. Sometimes I've done this exercise and people use that as a way to get them going back into their past experience. But you can just begin with the name of the street, with the name of the town, the name of a location, whatever it is that gets you moving, gets the pen coming across the paper. And then you want to think about some of the steps that he makes along the way. So he says right away where you could feel the silence. So what could you feel on your street? Is it silence? Is it chaos? Is it noise? Is it fear, confusion? What is it at a particular time? He's using summer as the season that represents his experience at Belfast. What would you say? I know there's only two seasons over here, if I understand this correctly. Which one is it? Long summer nights. So what kinds of nights for your piece? Is it nights of rain? Is it nights of heat? As the wire is played. So he's a musician, and he's always thinking of the soundtrack of his childhood. And he mentions music on several occasions in the poem. What is the soundtrack of your childhood? What songs, what music were you hearing? And it might be something, it could be a jingle from a television show, it could be the sound of a video game, but what is the soundtrack of your recollection of growing up in your earliest address? He uses landmarks. This is something that's really useful to consider, right? The spoken word piece is crammed with the names of places. So in his poem, we get Pineford Street, we get Beachy River, and that's kind of the orienting landmark. So he can tell somebody, go to Beachy River and take a left. Although I understand that in Ireland, if you're a devoutly Catholic, you give directions by saying which church is on the corner, and if you're not, you give the name of the bar. But Van Morrison's a kid, so it's Beachy River. And then he mentions a parade, orange field, Fusco's for ice cream. So the names of things, what kinds of names of things, the names of stores, the names of friends, the names of places, can you include to really fully map out the place where you grew up? He mentions activities. Sometimes it's dreaming in God. That's a very interesting statement, kind of a secular expression of a spiritual sense of recollection of childhood. Walks, watching the moth catcher, eating ice cream, gathering apples. So what are the things that, what kind of activities would you include to represent your experience of childhood? And let's see, a couple of other things that might be useful to consider. One is, I like the way he concludes the first section by saying the days before rock and roll. So he's writing about maybe 1951, 1952. What do you take for granted? What do we take for granted now that wasn't around when you were a kid? For me, that's just about everything. We didn't have, I mean, I grew up, we didn't even have zip codes. Zip codes were introduced maybe when I was 5 or 6. And our telephone numbers were 4 digits. I remember how baffled we were when they went to 7. So what's around now that we just accept as normal but wasn't around when you were a child? And these things, I think, are happening so rapidly today. I mean, the iPhone 6, or is that the most recent? 6 or 7? I mean, it just, every 3 or 4 months, it feels like everything I've already learned is obsolete. Facebook wasn't around, obviously. So when you're giving your recollection, it's in the days before a while. And finally, Van Morrison mentions the names of books that were important, right? So Billy Blue by Mez Mesro and Dharma Bums by Jack Kerouac. What kinds of texts? It could be magazines, it could be books, it could be the Bible. What kinds of things were around that were really important to you that kind of form your imagination as a child? It could be Harry Potter. There's a wonderful essay by the Chinese writer Yu Hua, and he talks about how everybody in China during the Cultural Revolution had two books. One was the sayings, the quotations of Chairman Mao, and the other was a collection of stories by Lu Sheng, the great writer. Everybody had them, they were always prominently displayed, and he claims nobody ever read them. They were just there because if somebody came into the house and saw that they weren't there, they might tell somebody that you're not honoring Chairman Mao. So books, what kind of books or texts make up your experience of childhood? I'm going to be here, I'll keep my eye on you, and, oh, yeah?
And also tell what the two things they could do wrong.
Ah, okay. There's only two ways that you can do an exercise wrong. One is not to do it. So you want to just get the paper, the pen going across the paper, or the fingers across the keyboard, see what happens. You do your word wrong. If you can do your fool, nobody is going to see these necessarily, so you don't have to worry about anything. And the other one is to revise. Write the critic. You can't be the critic now, because the critic is at war with the fool, and you'll be revising the first line over and over and over again before he gets the line to. So forget about revising, and forget about doing nothing. Do anything. There's no way to do an exercise wrong except those two. Okay? And there's the phone again. Okay. See if you can include that in the... I'll keep my eye on you. We'll go for 10 or 12 minutes, and if you need a little bit more time, we can take it. And then we'll see what you can do. Take it away. So maybe another minute on this?
Yeah. So
other candidates.
So if you can finish up that sentence, we'll go back to it later on tonight if you're still motivated. So I saw an awful lot of writing going on. How did it go? Do you feel as if you were able to tap into your distant past? Yeah? Here's a moment where we need a courageous soul who will stand up and share what they wrote. And then maybe we can talk a little bit about what happened. Anyone? Something else I do sometimes is I have everybody read aloud at the same time. That's another way to conceal what we've done. Does anybody feel like they want to share? This could be the springboard into literary thing. Or rock and roll thing.
This is like the big finish. That's
what I'm
the
big
finish.
Oh, no, no.
I'm sure a few lines. Impromptu poem. This is from 1983. Long you were born yet, okay? take me back on Harrow L 98 Street. You know, where Harrow is such an area. Have you been to Ilo Ilo? Okay, so take me back on Harrow L 98 Street, where the night stood still at 8:30. One long summer night, as the radio played Inspector Mills, and the cousins started to fight and argued whether the Scrabble blocks felt thrills, or we should start walking around the plaza and marvel around the story bell tower, or should we just stay home and play in the veranda? I'm just about to continue my work.
Victor, share your word. Come on, Victor.
In old Kaukaran, where the towers were silver and the woods were blue, where my people sang but spoke no heat, when the moon shone brighter than the sun in the sky, the melody of what Oran could make you cry. Far beyond Dampin's plain, across the cold conquers where I would linger, I think of you fondly, consider your memory, and wander away and think of you no longer. In old Kaukaran, where the summer was cold and the moon was bright, where the noise and the clamor rose higher than the waves, I remember the dark and the silence of the ages, in old Lemuria, now gone from the pages.
That's a great voice. That's a radio voice. And I like the way you were able to conjure up a sense of place through the way that you sounded. Really very good. Thank you. We have time for one more.
Take me back. Take me way, way, way back. On Pastrana Street, where you could feel the monsoon wind coming from the east. On long summer afternoons, as the radio played our mother's lazy Sunday tunes. Across the Aklan River, where our toes sank in the mud. In the stillness, as we listened to the girls in white veils muttering in the street. As we drifted into reverie, dreaming and and walking down the dirt-covered concrete on late summer afternoons, stealing mayflowers from our neighbor's wired fence that bloomed brighter than the harsh midday sun, watching the mahogany leaves drifting into the eaves, waiting for the first shower of rain, the Agua de Mayo.
Very good. All of you, that was the three that we heard, I think, were great examples of what you can do with an exercise like this. I wanted to do this exercise here because when we were in Chiang Mai, we did a workshop conference, and one of the participants is an MBA from NYU. He teaches business courses. He used to teach at NYU Shanghai. He's one of my colleagues there. And he's branched out into his own freelance work as much as possible, and he's writing a book. And his book concerns international negotiations. And he was at an impasse. He wasn't able to get beyond the concepts in the book because one of his ideas is to use the book or to center the book around conversations. So he's imagining scenarios with characters having interactions with each other. And then those scenarios will illustrate a point that he's trying to make about international negotiation and business. Primarily people from the West dealing with the Chinese, but I think applicable in all sorts of situations. And we did this exercise, and I thought that I was losing him completely, but he came up afterwards and he said, this has just opened up the book. Because he said that he wasn't really experiencing the characters as fully dimensional. And that as soon as he started thinking about where they came from and started to identify the specifics, the details of each of their locations, they started to come alive for him. So the conversation started to flow a little bit more smoothly, and we'll see what happens. But I thought, okay, if this can work, this works for poetry, it works for poems or evocative recollections, it might also work for something like business. Everybody, every character comes from somewhere, and it's really useful for you, the writer, to know where that is. If you don't consider it, then you're forgetting something very important. Ernest Hemingway used to say that you can leave out what you know, and you can't leave out what you don't know. So as long as you know the background and the location, where they ate ice cream, whatever it might be, you have a little bit more about the reality of the character. One final slide. Always good for a laugh. I don't care what's written about me as long as it isn't true. I hope you guys, however, get past the glib and write some true stuff. I'd love to read it. So thank you so much. This has been a really wonderful experience. You've been a wonderful group. Good luck with your life.
Thank you, Tim. I hope everyone learned something new tonight. Yes, they did. All right. Tim, before we go, we'd like to present you a token of appreciation.
This is like Butch Dalisai. Are you familiar with him? Yes. So he has a fetish for beautiful pens, antique pens. I'm going to have to call Butch and tell him I'm coming after him. Thank you so much.
It's a question of life. Your name is amazing. That's amazing.
He loves
it. Yeah.
Love
it. Thank you. We would like to thank everyone for coming over, especially the team that made this possible. The HR team, the marketing team, the social media team, and my ghostwriter, Kaisa.
Yay!
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm sorry, special mention. I'd like to also extend our thanks to Adobe Magazine. Thank you for coming.
And I wanted to make the suggestion, I hope the video is still running, GM is watching, that we do this again, but do it down in Palawan.
Thank you so much for having us, for having Tim. And we'd like to thank True Logic Online Solutions CEO Itamar Jero,
yes.
General Manager Bernard San Juan III, Content Manager MJ Navida, and of course, my dear cousin Maya Gilato. Phone call, and actually, could you hold this?
There's something we'd like to present to to your company.
Okay.
Do you know whether how you can, if you can
can teach about the difference between British English and American English.
Yes.
This book is called What Not to Write. Okay, and it actually has a list of British English and American English, and also a lot of stuff that Kim pointed out. Do not write this one. It's a boring phrase. What phrase can you use instead?
Oh.
So both these books hopefully
Thank you for coming. Have a safe trip back to New York. Until next year again, hopefully. And good night, everyone. See you tomorrow in the office.
Thank you.